In 1970, a television program debuted that changed the way millions of people looked at faith. The Hour of Power.
This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice.
Featuring the ministry of Robert Schuller, taught a generation that through God's love, your scars can be turned into stars. It was an idea that launched the most popular inspirational television program of its time. And today, the Hour of Power continues with a new voice for a new generation.
When you put your trust in God, nothing can stop you.
Pastor Bobby Schuller will encourage you and share a message that can give you a new perspective on life. Because whatever your circumstance or the obstacles you face, this moment can be your Hour of Power.
This is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Good morning, everyone. We're so glad you're here today. Hannah is sick today, so I'm all alone. You know, normally I have a friend here to, you know, make me look better, but not today. Hey, look, we're just so glad you're here today. We believe that God has called you to this place, that if you arrive with an open heart, God can do something tremendous in your life today. For all of you watching on television, thank you for joining us. We believe that God has a word for you. Turn around to those who are standing next to you, greet them warmly in the name of the Lord, and say, God loves you, and so do I. All right, friends, let's pray. Everybody take the deepest breath you can think of. Ready? Feels good, doesn't it? Actually sounds cool, too. Let's pray. Lord, we just take a moment and remember that today is the first day of the week, and we begin it with rest. We begin by centering ourselves in your love, the confidence of the cross and the resurrection, the power of the Holy Spirit. We thank you, God, that we do not walk alone, that you are with us. So, Lord, we pray that today your name would be lifted up, that great things would be done in this place, and we pray that in the name of Jesus, every chain would be broken, that your name would have power over the lives of every person here, and we pray it in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Oh,
You may be seated. Hear the word of the Lord in 1 Timothy chapter 6. For the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. Some people eager for money have wandered from the faith and pierced themselves with many griefs. But you, man and woman of God, flee from all this and pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, endurance, and gentleness. Fight the good fight of faith. Take hold of the eternal life to which you were called when you made your good confession in the presence of many witnesses. Command those who are rich in this present world not to be arrogant, nor to put their hope in wealth, which is so uncertain, but to put their hope in God, who richly provides us with everything for our enjoyment. Command them to do good, to be rich in good deeds, and to be generous and willing to share. In this way, they will lay up treasure for themselves as a firm foundation for the coming age, so that they may take hold of the life that is truly life. May God add his blessing to the reading of this, his word. Wow, thanks, guys. That's not amplified, right? If it is. I mean, that's amazing. That's a natural sound that we're hearing. It's wonderful. If you're at home, you got to come out to Shepherd's Grove sometime and visit with us. The music here is unbelievable, and there's nothing like sitting here in this church hearing this music live. There's no Bose 7.1 surround sound that can mimic what it feels like to sit here. Can I get an amen from a church? All right. Well, my guest today is Nancy Alcorn. Nancy is the founder of Mercy Ministries, designed to help girls from age 12 to 28 who are facing debilitating circumstances. Mercy teaches a Christian lifestyle with tools designed to break free from the destructive cycles so women can live healthy and independent lives. Would you welcome with me Nancy Alcorn? Hi, Nancy. Hi, so nice to see you.
Good to see you.
So just tell us a little bit about kind of what you're doing. How did you get started in working with ministry?
Well, you know, you learn a lot from things of what not to do. And I started out working for the government in Tennessee with juvenile delinquent girls in a girls' prison. And there were 300 of them locked up at any one given time. And I was there for 5 years. And then I spent three additional years in emergency child protective services investigating child abuse cases. And in government work, we're told we can't share Christ. And I knew that the same Christ that changed my life would change theirs. And it was very frustrating because the teenage girls that I worked with, a lot of them would go home and commit suicide or die from drug overdoses or get murdered by pimps or end up in the women's prison. Yeah. And when I investigated the child abuse cases three additional years, the Lord showed me, he said, I saw little boys and little girls being sodomized and raped and used and abused in all kinds of ways. And God said, you just spent 5 years dealing with angry teenage girls, and now I'm taking you back in time and showing you why they had so much anger and so many issues, because these are the things that happened to them. So 8 years of working for the government, Bobby, I realized that God has not called the government to heal broken hearts and to bring people to freedom. He's called his people to do it.
That's a great point. I mean, first of all, hearing this job description, first I want to say thank you. But second, I imagine that has to be a nightmare in the sense that you're in the worst kind of evil, you know, bad things being done to and by children. And so I wish we had more time to talk about a theology about how you navigated through that. But today we're really talking about your calling. And so you felt like, I love what you said, the government can't, you know, the government can provide basic needs, but it can't be compassionate.
Right.
And so you decided to start this nonprofit, this Mercy Ministry.
Right. In 1983, God gave me three core principles that we still operate by today. He said, I want you to take the girls in free of charge, and the program will be an average of 6 months. Whatever their problem is, Jesus is the answer. So eating disorder, self-harm, unplanned pregnancy, addictions, sex trafficking, sexual abuse, every issue a young girl could face, we deal with, and the girls have to want to come, so take the girls that want help free of charge. Secondly, God showed me never take any government funding or any other money that restricts the freedom to share about the only one who can give you a new heart and a new spirit and forgive sin. And then the third thing God showed me is that your needs will be met through your giving. So as an organization, tithe 10% to other organizations that are helping hurting people, and I will take that and put you on the hearts of people, and they'll give. So we have, we're working on our fifth location in the United States, three international locations. We have 40, but usually about 23,000 square foot buildings, 40 bed facilities in all the different locations. We take girls from all 50 states, and all of our buildings are debt free, but we have to constantly pray in the money for operating costs.
You know, that we have millions of people watching all over the world, and just as you're talking, I'm starting to think about all the parents that are at home that have a girl that's run away, or a daughter, you know, that's struggling with drug abuse or depression, suicide, things like that. What kind of advice can you give to parents who are in that horrible season when you don't know if your kid's going to be okay, what to do to help them? You must have learned a lot. Is there anything that you can...
Well, I would say that in Christ, there's always hope.
Yeah.
You know, there's a huge difference between treatment programs and transformation programs. And Christ will transform your life. Treatment deals with symptoms. Christ gets to the root of the problem and sets people free. So that's the difference. So I would say, do not spend a lot of money on programs that look good and sound good on paper, but the lives aren't changing. Find one that is Christ-centered. And if people want to look our way, mercyministries.com. All the information is there about how to apply, and we take girls from all 50 states.
I also think that, I know, you know, being in pastoral ministry now for about 10 years, I've seen lots of families that have teenage or young girls that are going through the season. A lot of it seems like just don't give up on them, right? I mean, a lot of it's just be present, don't quit, don't give up. A lot of it's a time thing. And I often feel like that so often these girls, a lot of times the kids are, boys and girls, are testing their parents to see if they truly love them, if they're going to give up. There is something to endurance, don't you
think? There is absolutely something to endurance. And God tells us that we are to stand and believe and use our faith and speak words of affirmation over our children. He said, if you raise a child in the way they should go when they're old, they will not depart. He didn't say what would happen in the in-between time.
Yeah.
So sometimes that gets a little heavy. But, you know, it's so true that if we don't give up, because, I mean, look at the Apostle Paul. He called himself the worst of all sinners, and look at what God used to do with his life. So we actually use him as an example to all of our girls. Look, if God could change this dude and send him out to transform the world, he can use you, and it's pretty exciting.
You have an amazing book coming out in October called Ditch the Baggage, Change Your Life. What's that about? I mean, I'm sure it's coming out of, the title's very compelling.
Well, actually, God showed us that the same principles of freedom that we've used inside the walls of mercy to bring tremendous transformation for 32 years will also work. The principles are the same. You don't have to come to a building. Yeah. And so God showed us to develop, to write this book and develop a curriculum study guide and all that for people who, outside the walls of mercy, as an outreach tool. And so we've done beta testing groups all over the United States, and we're getting amazing testimony back from all demographics of people that are actually experiencing freedom through just going through, and it's evaluating their self. You know, if we need to forgive, sometimes people are mad at God. So, you know, we know that God, we want God to forgive us, but sometimes we have to forgive ourselves and forgive God because we're mad at him because we think he should have stepped in. Mm-hmm. And it's about taking responsibility for our own choices, but also realizing that the choices we make today can change our yesterday and take us to a new place tomorrow. It's really an in-depth study, and it's awesome. We're excited about it.
One of the neat things about what we're doing is that this just goes out to millions of people. Mm. And we have a ministry that goes right where the people are hurting, right where a lot of women are in this type of environment. And Nancy Alcorn, if you wanted to just say one thing to hurting women who feel broken, lost, caught up in this kind of a world, what would you say to them?
Well, first of all, I would say that there is no such thing as a hopeless case in Jesus Christ. He came to seek and save that which is lost. He is able to save to the uttermost. And if anyone is out there and they need help knowing how to get there, they can contact me and I will sow a free copy of that new book into their life, because if they'll apply those principles, because they're not my principles, they're God's principles, they'll bring that freedom.
Amen. And no matter who you are, if you're watching on television or any of you here in the church, we want you to know that wherever you are on the road of life, with all of your doubts, your brokenness, your confusion, your loss, your anger, when you say, I'm surviving, we want you to know God loves you. You have a great purpose, a great calling. Take one more step and never give up on him. Nancy, I'm so thankful that you're here today. Her book, again, is called Ditch the Baggage, Change Your Life. And it's an awesome book. I want to encourage everyone to get it. Thank you so much for being here with us. God bless you. And we're going to continue to watch as God does tremendous things in your ministry.
For the folks that are here today, I'll be out there doing a book signing after the service. I'd love to meet some people.
Great. Wonderful. Thank you, Nancy. We appreciate you. God bless you.
Christmas is just around the corner, and today we're continuing our tradition of offering a unique Christmas ornament to our Hour of Power viewers. Today, we are offering this beautiful angel ornament made of exquisitely glazed white and gold dolomite. Her dress and wings are gold, and her face beautifully hand-painted. She holds a dove, the symbol of peace and faith, as a reminder that Jesus is always with us and to have faith in him. Hang this Christmas angel on your tree, or give one as a gift to family and friends, neighbors, or co-workers. Just imagine the added joy and sparkle this beautiful angel Christmas ornament will bring to your home and heart this Christmas season. Pastor Bobby would love to send you this angel ornament for your gift of any size. Please know that whatever gift you send, large or small, will be truly appreciated. To receive your 2015 Hour of Power angel ornament, write, call, or go online today. Thank you, And remember always, God loves you, and so do we.
Thank you.
Thank you guys so much. Freddie Ravel, it's always great to have you in the house.
Very cool. Thank you.
As you can see, I'm milking time while Casey and the gang sets my pulpit. Thank you, Casey. It looks perfect. You nailed it this time. You know, the lines are parallel. I don't have to fix it. No, it's exactly. Can we just give a hand to Casey? I know we all love him. Say thanks. Thank you, everyone, for watching today. We're so glad that you're joining us, and everyone who's in the church, we believe that you are called here by God and that God has a word for you. If you're watching on television, come down to Shepherd's Grove. We want to meet you. This is an amazing experience we have here. I want to shake your hand. If you have children, bring them. We'll teach them the things of God. And as always, we want you to know that this is a place where you will be loved and you will be helped. It's a helped. It's a place where you belong before you believe. If you're on Twitter, follow me. I respond to everyone at least once on Twitter. Would you stand with us? We're going to say this confession together. Hold your hands out like this, a sign of receiving God's love. Would you say this with me? I'm not what I do. I'm not what I have. I'm not what people say about me. I'm the beloved of God. It's who I am. No one can take it from me. I don't have to worry. I don't have to hurry. I can trust my friend Jesus and share his love with the world. Thank you. You can be seated. If you're listening today and you feel beat up, perhaps you've gone through a terrible breakup or divorce. Maybe there is someone in your family who you've had a falling out with and it just happened, or maybe it's been going on for years, but your heart is breaking over the loss of this relationship. If you come to church today, or you're watching on TV and you feel a low sense of self-worth, of value, if you think that God is angry at you or that he's punishing you, this message is for you. God has a word for you today. Everyone that's here today that is beat up by life, I want you to know God has a word for you today, and it is that you, very simply, are the beloved sons and daughters of God. We are talking at length in a theme about this confession, the confession of the beloved that we say every single week. I'm not what I do have, not what people say about me. And I really want us to know that in the end of this sort of season of talking about it, we really know we are God's beloved sons and daughters. That it's our identity, it's who we are, it's something we carry with us all the time. Today we're going to talk about the idea that you are very simply not what you have. You are who has you. You are not what you have. You are the beloved sons and daughters of God. And that's very good news. Can I get an amen? What is your net worth? This is a question that is considered really inappropriate in our culture, isn't it? What's your net worth? And this is a phrase that has always driven me crazy. I don't like to use it. I don't like it when people say it. Because although what you're asking is, what are your assets over your liabilities? There is an undertone to this, that your actual value as an individual is based on what you have. Though nobody would ever say that, there is something to the language that feels both destructive and descriptive. Descriptive of how we feel about others. They say the difference between someone who is crazy and someone who is enthusiastic is how much money they have, you know? There really is something about money and wealth and possession that causes us to view people differently, even ourselves. And so I want to first move from the idea that your worth or personal value has anything to do with what you have accomplished and anything to do with what you have. And I don't mean just your possessions, and I do mean that, but I also mean whether or not you're a mother or a father, or whether or not you're a great parent, or whether or not you have lots of trophies on your wall, or whether or not you've done something really wonderful that you can brag to your friends about. Very simply, your value as an individual is not based on what you have. That your possessions, whether they be your actual physical, monetary, cool things that you own, or whether they be your trophies or your reputation or your family or your friendships or your relationships, that those things do not change your worth. Your worth is infinite, and we live in a world that would say otherwise. Your worth is based on the fact that God views you as his beloved sons and daughters, and that he would do just quite anything to have you home again, to have you walk the long, difficult, and even embarrassing path back home to say, "Father, I will be your slave," in which he grabs you and puts a robe on your back and a ring on your finger and says, "You are my beloved son. You are my beloved daughter. You don't have to earn anything. This is your home. You belong here. You're worth it." God is not disappointed in you. God does not wish he could have gotten someone or something a little better out of you. God does not love you as you should be. He loves you as you are. And that is the gospel of Jesus Christ. There is nothing we can do to earn or lose God's love. And that all the hope we have in this life and in the next is that his love, his grace, and his faithfulness is sufficient. The scriptures say, even when we're faithless, God remains faithful. He can't deny himself. He loves you. And this is the hope of every believer who knows Jesus Christ. Culture, though, portrays to us a very different message from, especially for young people today. The younger you are, the more clearly you get the message that it's really about money. This is a message from hell that is diminishing the value of every single young person that listens to this music, that watches the movies, that glorify the idea that your value is what you have, that your value is based on what kind of car you drive, what kind of house you have, what kind of relationships you have, if you've found love, if you've got it all together, if you've got a fantastic job, if you're changing the world, well, then you have value. And none of those things change your value. Music and art has become such in a place for young people that it is all about that for so many. And it has caused especially young people in the inner cities to fall into deep nihilism and depression. You wonder why hip-hop music is all about cash and bling and all of this stuff. It's because those men and women have come from the place where they have no value because they're poor. They've got the undergirded message that because they have nothing and they came from nothing, they're worth nothing. And so they say, well, look at this great suit I have, and look at this awesome car I have, and look at this beautiful house. It's coming from a culture that is telling young people today that you are what you have. But very simply, and no matter who you are, young or old, no matter what race, what background, not even whatever religion, whatever you believe, you are loved by God. And what we do matters. That we be strong matters. What we believe matters. But in the end, none of those things change this very simple fact that you are loved and that you'll never stop being loved. And that is very, very good news for sinners like you and me. Amen? Money will come. Money will go. Jobs will come. And jobs will go. Callings will come and callings will go. Luck will come and your luck will run out. Things will change. Of course, we don't believe in luck, but things will change in your life. But no matter what, know that it is not what you have that makes your life valuable. It is not what you've accomplished that makes your life valuable. Very simply, friends, you're valuable just exactly where you are. No matter what you're doing, you're worth it. How do I know this? I know because I know how much value Jesus has. And that was the price that was paid for you. Let me ask you that question again real quick. How much is Jesus worth? Did you know that God, that the Father loves you as much as he loves Jesus? As much as? That the Father takes as much pleasure in you as he took in Jesus and takes in Jesus. If it were not so, he wouldn't have given Christ for you. Think about Christ and the way that God blesses him before his ministry. At the beginning of the gospel's story, Jesus is baptized and the heavens open up and a dove flies around and this voice from heaven says, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." And many of us know this story. And the thing I want you to notice mostly about this story is that Jesus hadn't really done anything yet, at least in the story. He's a 30-ish year old guy, and he comes out of nowhere. And in the narrative, there is no report except for one miracle when he was 12, when he turned water into wine. And I guarantee you, although everybody else said, "We love you because you gave us a bunch of wine," that was not why God said it. Can I get an amen? That miracle did inaugurate the fact that the kingdom of God is about joy, that there's something to really be happy about, there's something to celebrate. But in fact, when Jesus was baptized in the water, he did not say, "I take pleasure in you because you've just done such a dang good job. Because you've lived a perfect life." Jesus hadn't gone to the cross. He hadn't given his life. He hadn't raised anybody from the dead yet. He had been a lowly, nondescript carpenter in a back road country, working on theaters and being obedient to God. And as a teenager, people stole his tools and he had to live like a normal guy, had to pay the bills, probably had a single mom, really didn't accomplish much. And here he's now steps into his calling and the Father says, "You are my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." Why is that important? Because all of the great things that Jesus did came after the declaration of the Father's love. That the power of Christ was rooted in his intimacy with the Father. And so this is the argument we always have against the gospel of grace. Well, if it's all about grace and if I can be forgiven, well, then it really is cheap grace, isn't it? Well, no, because true holiness comes out of intimacy, not willpower. True strength comes out of knowing God, not out of just trying harder and bucking up and pulling myself up from the bootstraps. So many of us in our walk in faith are always feeling guilty, always feeling down. We are out of juice. We are surviving. We are trying harder. And all we need is a touch from the Father. All we need is intimacy. And well, what to do, what is right. Can I get an amen? Amen. That is the gospel of grace, that you're not what you do. You're not what you have. You're not what people say about you, that you are worth it. And this is finally what I want to say. How much do you think God loves? How much do you think the Father loved the Son? How much do you think the Lord, that he would open up the heavens and lavish Jesus with his love and power? How much do you think he loves Jesus? And yet, that was the price for you. That was the price for you. That's what was paid for you. That's what the Father thinks of you. And, you know, many preachers and theologians and pastors say, "We're scum. We're not worth it. This is dumb," right? I mean, they wouldn't say it, but that's what it feels like. It's like God, you know, is like, well, we're just, you know. No. God's smart. If he paid the price, it was worth it. You are worth Jesus. There's a part of us that goes, "Oh, I don't know if you can say that." That's just what the Gospels say. Your life, your soul, your value is equal to, in the Father's eyes, he's willing to pay the price of Christ on the cross that you would be redeemed. Why? Because you and Christ are both God's kids. Jesus said, "No greater love has any man than this, than he lay down his life for his friends." There is no greater way that God could prove to you his immense, enduring, and unending love than to say, "The price is Christ, and I will pay it for you." It's overwhelming. What do you do with that? And so our nature is to say, "No, I'm not worth that," and to shrink back from that. But the great message of the gospel is that, yes, you are worth it. But to not be entitled, to not take it for granted, to not waste your life on finding your value in what you acquire. You are not what you have. You are who has you. And that is such a great great story. It's not we who are holding on to God. It is God who's holding on to us. So much of life, in large part, is letting go. A life with the open hand. A life of generosity, not a life of taking. A life of releasing to God, not a life of holding on. A life of trust, not a life of anger and violence, right? There's the posture of the open hand that comes when we say, my life is not what I hold, it's not what I have, it's not my masks, it's not my titles, it's not my relationships. It's just this one simple thing, the first love. That first God loved me. And that in that is my hope, my salvation, and my joy. I just want to say it again. The Father gave the Son on the cross for you. You were worth it. You are worth it. Yes, you were worth it. These are not my words. The Father did not make a mistake. It was not an accident. You were worth it. You are so loved. Timothy writes in Timothy chapter 6, he's writing about wealth in the church. This is a passage, it's become an axiom, money is the root of all evil. But the actual phrase is actually not money is the root of all evil, but the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil. When we look at a healthy approach to money, Paul says essentially in this passage, when he's talking to Timothy, who's a pastor in the church of Ephesus, I believe, he's telling him, look, there are rich people in your community and there are poor people in your community. Don't let them find their identity in what they own. When you read when you have a close reading of the text, you will see that Paul is saying, tell those who are rich, what? Not that they're evil or that they're bad or that they have to give everything away, but to be generous, to share, and to not put their hope in money. Why? He says in the passage, because everything you have in this world, you do not come into this world with anything, and you will not leave this world with anything. There is no hope in the things that you own. Where is our hope? Our hope is in the love of God that is found in Christ Jesus our Lord, crucified and resurrection for the salvation of your soul. It's not bad to be rich, but it's bad to put your hope in your wealth. And by the way, it's also bad to put your hope in your poverty and your pride in your poverty. And many people do that. Many people take pride in what they have, and many people take pride in what they don't have. Many people find their identity in the stuff that they have, and many people find their identity in the stuff they don't have. When I was working in ministry in the inner city, I asked a kid one time, what are you going to do when you grow up? And he said, it doesn't matter as long as I know how to sign my welfare check. This is someone who is coming out of the identity that I need other people, and I can never just work and survive on my own. There's an identity in poverty, and there's an identity in wealth, and both of them are lies. And they need to be abandoned for a greater identity that nothing you can earn or attain or lose in this life is worth what God has given you, eternal life. Because this life that we are living right now from A to Z is so short compared to the life in Christ that we'll have forever. That those things that you've attained in this life, you're just not going to care someday. And you're going to wish you had used the valuable time that you've been given on this earth for something better. It's so easy to lose your money, your possessions. It's so easy to lose your relationships. It's so easy to lose your job. Things come and things go, but one thing endures forever, and that is God's love for you and for the people you love, by the way. And that's good news. Jobs come and jobs go. You feel safe in your job? You know, how many of us put our identity in what we do for a living? Well, guess what? That job isn't going to be around forever. Someday you'll retire, or someday you'll get laid off, or someday your business will close. Then what? Many of us put our identity in our car. I will never forget, Don, this is a great story. Can I tell everybody what kind of car you drive? Is that all right? Can I tell everybody what kind of car you drive? Because it's a beautiful car. You don't care. You're a classy guy. You know, Don was a professor at UCLA and has an illustrious career. Anyway, at the Crystal Cathedral, I was pulling up. I don't know if you saw my old Camry. I was driving a 1999 Toyota Camry that had 260,000 miles on it, and it looked every bit. This is a car that I bought in Oklahoma and that spent most of its life in the snow and summers of Oklahoma. And I drove it out here to California when I started preaching at the Crystal Cathedral in all its glory. And I was the teaching pastor of this church. I would pull up my car that anytime I would turn the wheel, it would go. The paint was diminished. The ceiling, part of the ceiling, and I'm talking at the Crystal Cathedral, was drooping like a tent. It made me feel like I was camping. And I pulled into the cathedral and I'm preaching. I preached a sermon on the importance of embracing some deaths in order that you may embrace new life. Right? So you have to die to some things, you have new life. And I'm pulling out of the church after giving this great sermon. If you remember the cathedral, there's these lanes. And this car, my car broke down in the Crystal Cathedral parking lot. And there was like all these baller cars, you know, from Orange County, you know, nicest cars. And finally, somebody way in the back pulls around in this beautiful Cadillac right next to me, and the window comes down, and it's Don Newen. And he says, "Bobby, I heard a great sermon on it, letting old things die that you might get new things." Yeah. It's time to get a new car. So, you know, I'm a big fan of Dave Ramsey, so I don't like spending tons of money on things. So I did the best I could, Don. I got, in 2013, I got a 2011 Camry that was beautiful. You don't care. It's not that great. One of these days, you know, I'll have a, anyway. So, but my point was, there was something about having that old beater car that was different than having a brand new car, and it was this, that I just didn't care about it. And now, anytime something happens in my car, I'm like, oh, look, when I got my first dent. I'm like, oh, ooh. And well, I'm very, very glad I got a car, and it was very good advice, because now I'm a lot safer than I used to be. I just want to say this. You can't possess something without it possessing you just a little. You can't own something without it owning you at least a little. You can't hold on to something without it holding on to you at least a little. Our houses and our mortgages and our retirement accounts. We're gonna lose all that stuff. Then what will we have? Anybody like Monopoly? Me too. First slide, Monopoly. That's the game. Next slide. We all know this to be true. Can we go to the next slide, please? This is how the standard Monopoly game ends. That's right. We all know it. I stole this, like all of my good jokes, I stole this from Instagram. And, you know, if we play Monopoly, it always gets really heated. And yet, it's fake! It's fake, guys! There's always the guy or the girl that's like, what if this money was real? Right? There's always, like, every time. There's always the one guy you're not sure if he's bending the rules a little to win. Monopoly is such a great reflection of our culture. Monopoly began during the Great Depression, and it became like this thing that endorsed the fantasy of all Americans to break out of poverty, and it was good in that way. But there's also a deeper symbolism. John Ortberg told a story about playing Monopoly with his grandma, and he said, every time they would play, she would beat him. She would take his last dollar. She would take every bit of everything he had. And he would look at her and she said, "Son, someday you will learn to play the game." And he said, eventually that summer came and he played Monopoly with his friend every single day. They played Monopoly and he learned the game. He learned that the game of Monopoly was a 100% commitment to total acquisition. And when he returned that fall to play his grandma, John Ortberg says that he took everything she had. And when she extended her hand to hand him that last dollar bill, she said, "Son, you've learned how to play the game. You know that it's all about total acquisition." She said, "Let me teach you one more lesson. Now, it all goes back in the box. Every house, every hotel, every title, those utilities, those railroads, and all that wonderful money, it all goes back in the box." And he said, "But I don't want it to go back in the box." And she said, son, it all goes back in a box. It does. Everything you've acquired, your house, that big buy, your cars, your trophies, your books, your portfolios, even your body, will all go back in the box. Then what? Where is the hope for a people who have found their value in things that someday they will lose? Where is the hope for people like us? It is in this, that the maker of heaven and earth, the one who made your soul and your body and everything that is good in this world, loves you and would never let you go to waste and would never lose you, and that he gave his son for you, and that you are worth it. And so know who you are, friends. Know that you are an unceasing spiritual being with an eternal destiny in God's great universe. Know who you are. Know that you are loved and that the one who loves you has the power to sustain you forever. Don't run away from him. Allow the one who loves you to be the true source of your strength, because strength does not come from willpower. It comes from a hope in this love and power, knowing that this one who loves us will never let us go. It doesn't matter if you let him go. He will never let you go, and that is very good news. It is great news to know. When the world praises you and rejects you, when the world laughs at you, or when the world lifts you up, when you make lots of money, when you lose everything, it doesn't matter. Because the true wealth that you have is in the Father's love. And if you can know this love, your life will never be the same. And that is very good news. You are not what you have. You are who has you. God gave his son for you. You were worth it. Let's pray. Lord, what do we do in a world where we live in doubt and we wonder where you are? And what do we do in a world that so often evil wins? And when will Christ be satisfied? And when will the kingdom be on earth? And so we ask these questions, Lord, in the midst of our struggles and in our challenges, our addictions, our doubts, our fears, our losses, our broken relationships, our quirks in our personalities, and our brokenness in our society and in the life and all of the tragedy that happens. Lord, we're like David, Lord, we are asking you, would you come? And would you fill our hearts with your power and with your life? I don't want to dismiss anyone without giving you the opportunity to know this love personally. Would you repeat this after me? If you want to become a Christian today, and even if you're already a Christian, repeat this after me. Father in heaven, you love us. You are our loving maker. You won't let your creation go to waste. You gave your son for us. Our sins are forgiven. Our past is redeemed. Our future is blessed. Because we trust in Jesus. It's in his name we pray. Amen. And if you prayed that prayer for the first time, or if you need prayer for anything, feel free at any time to leave. There are people with blue lanyards in the back. They'd be happy to meet you. Just go back and to the left if that's you. Thank you. And now, choir, bless us with your music. Everyone, let's stand and sing together. and now the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Christmas is just around the corner, and today we're continuing our tradition of offering a unique Christmas ornament to our Hour of Power viewers. Today, we are offering this beautiful angel ornament made of exquisitely glazed white and gold dolomite. Her dress and wings are gold, and her face beautifully hand-painted. She holds a dove, the symbol of peace and faith, as a reminder that Jesus is always with us and to have faith in him. Hang this Christmas angel on your tree, or give one as a gift to family and friends, neighbors, or co-workers. Just imagine the added joy and sparkle that this beautiful angel Christmas ornament will bring to your home and heart this Christmas season. Pastor Bobby would love to send you this angel ornament for your gift of any size. Please know that whatever gift you send, large or small, will be truly appreciated. To receive your 2015 Hour of Power angel ornament, write, call, or go online today. Thank you, and remember always, God loves you, and so do we.
Join us again next week as Pastor Bobby Schuller brings you a message of hope on the Hour of Power. And when you visit our website, you'll discover books, devotionals, and other resources to take your Christian life to a new level. And Pastor Bobby would love to hear from you. Just write us. And when you do, consider supporting this incredible ministry on a regular monthly basis. We're taking a life-changing message literally around the world. And your regular financial support makes all the difference. Until next week, remember to let your hopes, not your hurts, shape your future.